Good evening, everyone. I would like to call this meeting of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee to order at 6:35 p.m. Due notice having been posted. Let the record show that this meeting is being electronically recorded, and if anyone in the audience also wishes to electronically record this meeting, you should notify the committee at this time. Any such recording may be subject to reasonable restrictions imposed by the chair to the extent permitted under the open meeting law. Roll call. Mrs. Gagliardi?
Here.
Mrs. Field?
Here.
Mr. Ghilarducci?
Here.
Mrs. Rothwell?
Here.
Mrs. Terra?
Here.
Mr. Larabee?
Here.
And the chair is present. Also with us tonight, we have the Superintendent of Schools, Jeffrey Schoonover, our Director of Business and Finance, Lindsay Albanaz, our Recording Secretary, Robin Vaccaro, and we also have with us John Myron, who's a student at Somerset Berkley Regional High School, and we'll introduce John further shortly. Before we begin our meeting, I think everyone is aware of the tragedy that struck our community over the last couple of weeks with the death of Asriel Esther Brooks, a fifth grade student at the North Elementary School. It's a tragedy that's very difficult to understand, and we have tremendous sympathy for Asriel's family and for her loss. So I would ask if we can observe a moment of silence in memory of Asriel and with our thoughts going to her family. Thank you. I'd ask everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So I'd like to welcome John Myron to our meeting. As you may be aware, based on conversations that we've had in the past, we've been anxious to have a student representative at our school committee meetings. So John is the president of the senior class and has agreed to serve as the student representative to our committee for the remainder of the school year. The student representative is an ex officio member of the committee, has an opportunity to participate in the discussion on issues, but does not vote, and generally does not attend executive sessions. And also, I'm sorry to say, John does not receive any compensation for your service, but we're very glad to have you. Thank you for your willingness to serve. So the first item we have on our agenda, the next scheduled meeting of the committee will be on May 11th, 2016 at 6:30 p.m. in the Somerset Berkley Regional High School Library. We have minutes of our meeting of April, the open session of April 7th, 2016. I'll entertain a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mrs. Field. Is there any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
I
unanimous. I believe there were two people who were absent from that meeting, Mrs. Terra and Mrs. Rothwell.
Yes.
So there were five in the affirmative and two abstentions. John, here's a copy of the packet. Pass it.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item we have under communications is the superintendent's update.
Well, is there anything that I think number one on the list is John? Is there anything that
Well, I introduced John.
Oh, would you like to, is there anything that, I wasn't sure if John was going, had anything to contribute with this?
Well, sure. First, just a quick few seconds, I won't take too much of your time, but I did, for the reason why this ended occurring was because I did want to come and actually speak to the school committee on a separate issue, and then this just coincided, so I'll take a few minutes of your time if that's okay. But first, I did want to thank you for inviting me to be a student rep on this committee. I'm very honored and also very happy to express a student perspective at these things. One of the things that we talked about at Future Search, we talked about in the school, is a disconnect between the administration, school committee, other members of the community, and students. And I think this is a good step in bridging that, and I think we have a long, long way to go, but this is a great start, and I'm very happy for that opportunity. The thing I wanted to talk about in the past was just a reminder of how the student voice is extremely, extremely important. And I'm not just saying that because I do like to hear myself talk, that may be true, but the student voice, especially when it comes to decisions with the school, decisions that directly affect the students, because they will be extremely honest in what's necessary and what's unnecessary and what they need. And the reason why I was prompted to make this a topic of discussion was because I have, within the past few weeks, been bombarded by many different outside community members, community divide is a strong word, but we can use it, by many different community members to do things for the students, which is extremely appreciated. But when someone comes to you, it's like me coming over to your house and we're all invited for dinner, but I'm telling you what's on the agenda for dinner. It's like we want to open up a discussion between members of the community and students to find something that we want to do. So there was other things with people planning different things in the community and issues like that. And I'm just here to say that the student, if we ask them and we work together with them, it's always, help is always appreciated. And I just wanted to remind everyone that whether it comes to new decisions with technology and the movements in the school, the student perspective needs to be heavily, heavily engaged, because they're going to be the ones most impacted by these decisions. So like I said, this is perfect beginning of it, because we can actually start to hear where students are standing on a lot of other issues that may affect them, and that was my piece there. The other thing is, and I know I've been updated very frequently with the recycling at our school, we're almost there, we're getting there. I heard they're on back order still, and I don't know if that's changed, but that has not changed. And I know that it's not any fault here at all, but I'm just very happy that we're moving in that direction. And again, this will be another forum to continue things like that. So that is it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I just can say we've been anxious to have a student representative attend our meetings for some time, John, and there's actually we would like to have even broader input. There's actually a statutory provision that provides that we should meet bi-monthly with a group of students, and we're anxious to do that, and so it's a matter of getting that accomplished. So that's one aspect of it, and the second is we agree, and I know that there's strong feeling among the students based upon the Future Search event that we had to implement the recycling program. So with your, you know, your pushing, I've been kind of pestering our director of business and finance about those bins, and unfortunately it's kind of out of her hands. We're waiting for our vendor to provide them, but we'll stay after them as much as we can to get that going before the end of the school year.
Well, we have started it. I mean, we are doing it in the student dining center. We do have a recycling bin out back, and we do have recycling containers in the hallways of the building currently. So the bins, unfortunately, because they're free, we have to wait, but we're working on it.
So now I can, sure. Superintendent's update.
And I'd just like to, you know, thank John for being here. And when he and I spoke maybe about a month or so ago about him attending these meetings, we both discussed that. As a senior, John only has a few meetings, a few school committee meetings left before he graduates. But he thought this would be a great opportunity for him to experience three or four of these meetings, and that way, whoever takes on this role next year, he can relay the information, what he's learned, and prepare that person, whoever the student is who replaces him, for next year, and so we can start out right away with a student representative at these meetings. So with that, and I know both probably Mr. Ghilarducci and Mr. Peirce will talk about this, so I won't spend too much time, but earlier this week, we attended the Day on the Hill. This was on Tuesday. I know Mr. Peirce, I see in front of him, has a couple of folders, so I'm sure he'll be sharing some information, but it was a great event. We were able to sit down with both Representative Haddad and Senator Rodericks, who were both very gracious with their time. We're talking about different issues, which I'll let Mr. Peirce, I'm sure, inform us more in a little bit. I want to inform the committee that, good news, Mrs. Nicole Copeland, who is an AP English language, English teacher here, but she teaches AP English language and composition. She has been selected by the College Board to be an AP reader at the end of this school year, so she will go to, I forget where it is, I want to say Kansas City, but I'm not sure if that's correct or not, but serving for 1 week just reading AP English language exams. And as a former AP teacher, I always wanted to do this. I never had the opportunity, but she's going to be going, and I know she's going to, it's a wonderful professional development opportunity for any AP teacher, so she will be going to that. That's it's not easy to be selected as an AP reader, so congratulations for her for that. Mr. Peirce mentioned Azrael Estabrooks. What I wanted to mention was just the community effort this past week or so, and particularly with this committee, just to share with you, which I probably have already through emails, but just to let the community know that we had so much support at North Elementary School throughout this week. We have one school psychologist who's there. We brought in a counselor from the middle school, both an adjustment counselor and school psychologist here from Somerset, Berkley, spent part of the first 3 days of this week at North Elementary supporting students and teachers. We also had a counselor and psychologist from Berkeley. Mr. Lynch graciously donated a couple of his staff members to come over and help us. They were with us all day Monday, and I did see them again on Tuesday with students. So it was just, it was a great community outreach for people just to come in, knowing that that this was really a tragic event, and just so many people were willing to lend a helping hand. In addition to them, we also had a counselor from Aponequit Regional High School who also came and supported students at North on Monday. Just shifting gears a little, we have a few events happening at the high school this weekend. Beauty and the Beast, I mentioned this last at our last meeting, but starting Friday night at 7 p.m. We have two shows on Saturday, 1 p.m. and 7 p.m. And then again, a matinee on Sunday. It sandwiched between the two shows on Monday, it will be the Envisioning Somerset in the art gallery here at the high school. And I know it's still being set up. I walked through there this afternoon. The photographs that are up are absolutely amazing. So I encourage the committee, I encourage the public to come on Saturday afternoon to see the photographs that our students have taken around Somerset and Berkeley. It really is magnificent, with a lot of history involved with it too. It's just not photographs, but really tells a great story about our two towns. AP exams, I should have said this after Nicole Copeland, our students are preparing for AP exams. Historically, those always take place during the first 2 weeks of May. I think AP chemistry is the first one that always gets the students take first thing on Monday morning, but those will be scheduled over the next 2 weeks, usually two exams per day, one in the morning, one in the early afternoon. And lastly, something that I mentioned last time about Full Life Ahead. It's a series of special education related workshops. We have the next one coming up already this coming Tuesday, May 3rd. It's from 6 to 8 p.m. in the Distance Learning Center here at the high school. It's called Going to College, Why Not? And this is with the Massachusetts Families Organizing for Change, working with the Somerset Berkley Regional High School Special Education Department. And the emphasis of this one is talking about promoting students with disabilities attending college. So for those who might be interested in attending, they can just show up. They could always email Mr. Mello, Tom Mello, mellot@sbregional.org if they wanted to attend or have some additional questions. There is some information on the school's website about that. Thank you.
Thank you. I had intended to go to that program on college for students with disabilities, but we have a policy, a rather important policy subcommittee meeting that night, so I'm not sure that I'll be able to get there. So I'm sorry that I'm not going to be able to make it, because I thought it was, I think it's a very worthwhile program, and I was interested in hearing the speaker. Okay. Next item we have under communication, Mr. Schoonover is visiting students.
So unfortunately, we didn't have any of our students show up tonight because it was my understanding that they're all bowling as we speak, or they were bowling. They were going out bowling late afternoon, early evening. So they were unavailable to attend this evening. But we have had 16 students spending the week here at Somerset Berkley Regional High School. We've also had two chaperones. I don't want to butcher the name of the province. Xinjiang, I believe, is in the northwest corner of China, bordering Russia and many of the former Soviet republics, Afghanistan. So it's nestled in that section of China. They've been in the U.S. for about a week before attending Somerset Berkeley. But they have spending their weeks with host families. They came in Saturday evening and just spending time here, seeing what it's like to be in a U.S. high school, trying to understand if this is something that they want to do for a full year. They're really testing the waters for that long-term, year-long or half-year commitment to studying abroad, and also seeing if attending a U.S. college might be in their future. But we will have, after this week concludes, I will make sure that we have either Mr. Lenzinski or someone else, maybe one of the host families, come and share with us their experience, just so we can learn if this is something that we want to encourage and promote more in the future or not.
I have a question.
Yes.
Can you explain the process of how families, host families, were chosen?
We first, Mr. Lenzinski approached the Big Buddies and identified students from that group. We have 8 female students and 8 male students who are with us. Through the Big Buddies, we were able to, I believe we secured all of the female students. We didn't want to cross, we didn't want to have a male exchange student with a female host student. So we were able to fulfill the obligations for the female students, I believe one male student, through the Big Buddies, which left us with 7 male students who we needed to find host families for. And actually, Mr. Larabee, David Larabee, was willing to take on 5 of them. So 5 have been staying with him. Mrs. Sheen here at the high school, I believe, has 1 or 2. So we went back to some of the other people who volunteered, who don't have children here attending the high school, who will have to take on some students. So it was really this effort, first starting to find students here, which is really the requirement. And then, since we didn't have many male students who were willing to step up, we had to go outside to find them.
And what was the process for people that might be, was there anyone that was denied?
kind of families, host families. I'm just running the process, but I just kind of heard that some people that were interested, and some of the more kids than other people didn't have an opportunity, so I was really curious of how that process worked.
It was, no one was denied at all. It really came down to, after the students in the Big Buddies, after those students were connected with host families, then we looked at what's left, and then we went out to find other families who were interested. There was a family who has a female child here at the high school who volunteered, but because it was a female student, we only had male students remaining. That's why there wasn't a connection that was made there.
Okay, I'll just run the application process if there was something that was missed.
There really wasn't an application process. It was calling the principal and finding out and saying that you were interested and seeing if there was a matchup that we could make.
So we didn't have enough to like spread them out, we had to do five, maybe it was family?
It was, yes. We could not, we didn't have enough people who were willing to take on these families.
Thank you.
But I thought we discussed it at least one, if not more, of our meetings in terms of inviting people to contact the high school if they were interested in being a host family. So I thought that there was information available for anyone that was interested in participating, and I would have thought that a general appeal would have been made, or I was actually, I think, led to believe that there was an email sent out to students to see if any of their families would be interested in hosting a student.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. So the priority started with trying to match current students with
yes.
those businesses.
I just would like to see that we had to put five with one family. Like maybe next time we need to have the families first before we, what happens if we had 20 kids? We really need to kind of organize this a little better, I think, in the future and make sure that we have families. Because I remember there was a conversation about we really shouldn't have families having the same culture in the same house because they might just talk among themselves. Mm-hmm. And then we kind
That's
of.
True.
Well, that was more.
But
geared
it was
towards
otherwise we didn't have families to host these students.
And
so
those parameters were specific for host families that were taking on a student for the entire semester.
Yeah.
Where we were a lot more strict with setting those parameters about what was allowed and what wasn't allowed. This was more of a visit for that. But I do agree that if we're going to invite students, we should have
right.
a process in place so we can make sure that we can house them.
And this was these were dates that the Cambridge Institute gave us, right? It wasn't really something that we.
We had about a 2-week window to, from the day we were informed until we had to have all of the names back to the Cambridge Institute so they could run their background checks and do the necessary work on their end. So we had a very, very short window to find 16 host families. Unfortunately, we're only able to find about 10 or so. And again, it was really the male students that were the difficult ones to find. Many of our female students, or we had enough female students who were willing to take some on, but it was really finding a male student here who was willing to have a host, an exchange student stay with them. So because of that, it was very difficult.
So what I was thinking, because you said that one family needed to have a female, there wasn't enough time to reorganize, so they could have got a female, someone else could have got a male. They were already decided. I'm just wondering if there should be like a kind of a policy to look at in the future of, you know, what is the criteria for a family to host a child, even if it's for a week or two, so it's a fair process of who applies, and to make sure we have enough host families to service.
I think probably the timing, in fact, the genders just didn't match up.
Well, it's interesting that the young women at the high school were apparently much more willing and open to hosting a student than were the young men, but I don't know what the dynamics of that are.
I think it was great. I just would like to see it kind of spread out a little bit and not take kids that we can't house.
Yeah.
I would like to have seen that as well, but it was, otherwise we would have had 16 students coming and four students we simply wouldn't have had, or five students actually, we wouldn't have had a place for them to stay. I mean, we simply didn't have the numbers.
So this could be feedback for Cambridge to say.
Yes, and we are, there will be a debrief with them next week. They will be meeting with both Mr. Lenzinski, Mrs. Brelsford. I hope to attend that, and they will provide their feedback on what worked this week and what did not, what has not worked.
Yeah. And can this be looked at in the future for policy of the criteria for those families? Is this the same as we would for someone that would have for the whole year?
It's a different process.
This is just a short-term thing, right? This
right.
And I don't think we would do this necessarily do this every year. This was really just to kickstart this.
Right.
Well, it is part of the recruiting process, at least theoretically that was the idea of it. We'll see at the conclusion whether that really worked out and make a decision about whether we want to host this kind of a program again. All right. Under consent agenda, acceptance of $200 from donorschoice.org. And do we have the email here? I know I have seen it. Mrs. Albernaz, would you like to just explain this?
Mr. Ramos, he was the teacher who did the presentation, I think, three meetings or so ago about the engineering courses that he teaches. He had been proactive and wanted to reach out to get some funding for a small project that he wanted to do for his class. Under this fundraiser, he was given a similar to like a purchase card, but it's more like a donor's choose card where you have to use the funds that are preloaded onto the account once your fundraising limit has been hit by various sources online. So he got this card, more like a debit card, to purchase the materials that he wanted to use for this small project for his students. He did supply me with the receipts of everything that was utilized out of that card, and it is all related to his project that he wanted to do for his students. I wish I could tell you exactly what the details of the project. I just know it was related to the presentation that he had done here a while ago, and he was really excited about it. And I think being that proactive is something that we should strive for with all of our teachers as far as getting some outside funding. I just need to let the school committee know, so to let you know that I reviewed the finances, and you just need to accept it as a donation of all the things that he purchased.
I just add that he's also the one that designed the grand prize float for the parade, and he's just very talented, and he's really into his work with the students. He does a good job.
I just have a quick question. The email references 220. Did he spend $220 or 200? Or does it make a difference?
I think it was 200. I don't remember 220. I can check.
So I have a question. I think this is wonderful to have our teachers be proactive with something like this. But as Donors Choose becomes more and more of a popular way to raise funds, I think it would be prudent for the school committee to develop a policy surrounding Donors Choose. Just, Dean, to answer your question, just so we have some type of itemization. Again, Donors Choose is a wonderful way to raise money for individual projects, but I do think if we're seeing something, this type of trend take off, we should probably be proactive in how it's monitored, and not even monitored, but how it's accounted for, because I believe from an accounting or an audit perspective, you are probably going to need some detail, and if we can get ahead of it, that might be better.
Right, so what I had emailed Mr. Lenzinski to as a follow-up to this, because I have a feeling this is going to start picking up with teachers, which is a great thing, but we need to have some transparency about it. They need to let me know first. I need to know the criteria of the donations, and I also need to get periodic updates of what is being purchased with that. And at the end, we'll close it out, and we'll get a final, as you can see from the receipts, a final kind of listing of what they purchased and if there's any balance left on the card.
Right, because we want to avoid duplication of effort.
Right, and we also, I mean, the principal, he has to ultimately sign off on what the project is. I would think that he wouldn't be letting teachers do the same project. You know, I think that's just a waste of resources. But there is a process now, and it involves me, and I can always talk to Jeff if there is, you know, a problem or concern.
Great.
You know, I think it's a valid concern, and that we should look at the possibility of input from the superintendent, having a policy. I think a teacher that wants to utilize this fundraising method should at least inform the principal in advance and be sure that it's consistent with long-term objectives.
Right, and we certainly don't want to stop a teacher's innovation or fundraising efforts, seeking grants and so on, but we want to make sure that what they are seeking, if it's sometimes this technology equipment, we want to make sure that Mr. Levesque is included in the process to make sure that the equipment being sought would work with our system, you know, or whatever it is, because obviously in the end he would take on the maintenance of that equipment. And or if it's curriculum materials, we would want to make sure that in addition to the principal, that our curriculum director has knowledge of it and gives her blessing, because we wouldn't want to have a situation where one teacher has something for his or her students and another teacher of the same class does not have something for those students. So looking at a policy where we identify those steps along the way, I think is an important thing for us to do.
Okay, so although the agenda says $200, I don't think it's a significant deviation. The email very clearly says that he received $220 and expended essentially all of it. So I will entertain a motion to accept a donation of $220 from Donor's Choice.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Field and seconded by Mrs. Rothwell. Any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, all is in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next, school committee evaluation. So we circulated a copy of the goals that we set for ourselves and an evaluation form, and Robin received responses and has prepared a summary. So, I think we can open it for discussion, if anyone has any observations. Why don't we take the goals one at a time? Strengthen collaboration among districts. Do you have any comments from our tri-district subcommittee?
Well, I think they reflect as far as we've gotten in the process. We you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we felt difficulty, we sensed some difficulty in proceeding, especially with identifying specific areas for collaboration, because that really had to be put in the hands of the administrations of the three school districts. So we talked about them in those meetings. We didn't really get them here, because a lot of times that had to be really vetted in much more detail amongst the administration to see. But I think we've made some progress, and I think we're able to get the full committee's approval today in establishing the regional planning board. I think that's one of the key.
That would be the start or the launching point.
Yeah, okay. I agree. If we were to do this again 6 months from now, I think that numbers would be a lot higher, because I think we're going to make a lot of progress in the next 6 months.
Yeah, and I think, not to make an excuse, but I think next time we're looking at this, I think it's important to recognize how much of this can be really in the hands of the school committee versus in the hands of administration. We can encourage it, but I think to a certain degree, it was really not something we could talk about it, but it wasn't really anything we could take on without both administrations.
And don't discredit the work you did, which it was part of this goal, and I see it as one of the key pieces to beginning it, was the review of the current agreement. And that is very important homework that needs to be done as we start to move forward, and the three of you have done that. So, and if I am speaking correctly, I don't think we've had a review of the recent agreement since it's been formed. So, very important piece before you get to that next step with the tri-district.
Yeah, and as simplistic as it says, you know, it seems to go through that agreement. There was a lot of dialogue and a lot of discussion, and what were those recommendations? And then we did have to go to the state to get their thoughts on that as well. So it was an interesting process.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we made significant progress on that goal, and it's still an ongoing process. So. Move on to the goal number two, development of a multi-year financial plan. Your thoughts on that from the budget subcommittee?
I think if you look at number four, just personally, we really couldn't make too much progress in aligning the budget changes with the strategic plan, as we're still in the process of developing the strategic plan. So, mm-hmm. But I think that's something that we should continue in the future. The other area where we scored a little lower was providing opportunities to key community members to be part of the budget process. Although I feel like we actually did make an effort to have many more budget meetings this year than we have.
I think one of the strengths of that goal in particular was the work our business manager had done to provide the background information and the binder information as we began our discussions. So we had a clear picture of what the finances were and how it was categorized by department. It's something that I had not seen while I'd been on the school committee. So I think that that was a great first step. We also had in Roger Hatch to talk about the Chapter 7 formula. I thought that that was a very good piece as well. And then as we start to talk more about how we can align our budget with our strategic plan or some of the things that we want to accomplish, we're going to start to be able to build a stronger, more cohesive plan.
I also think one thing that that we can be proud of this year is the work that our business manager did on number six to develop a budget projection methodology based on historical data. Mm-hmm. You know, the 3 to 5 year budget forecast that she has provided to the finance committees and to us is going to be a very useful tool as we move forward.
And we got a very positive response to that from Mr. Hope.
Yes,
that's always
that's
a very
rare. So,
I wasn't on the budget subcommittee, but seeing these scores, I actually was kind of surprised that they weren't a little higher, to be honest with you. I thought the work that Lindsay has done and the committee has done in regards to the transparency and working with the lines and making sure that the budget is aligned properly and the communication and how you collaborated with the teachers and the content coordinators up to the administration, I thought it was a pretty collaborative effort. So, just my opinion, I was a little surprised on the high twos to the threes. I thought it was more on the 3.5s to the fours, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Under number one, I think there is some further work that we can do there. I think that the school advisory council it has a role in the budget process, and I'm not sure that we've had much input from that group in the past, and hopefully we can achieve some input from students if we're able to move beyond simply having one student representative present and meet with a group of students on a regular basis. So at least to understand the areas where they think from their perspective there could be some improvements or issues that need to be addressed. So.
Well, speaking specifically to number one, too, I think there was a pretty concerted effort by the administration to make themselves available to discuss the budget after it had been discussed here with the different community members. I know that Mr. Schoonover's visit to Berkley was well received, and you know, his being there and answering questions that he answered during that selectmen's meeting was a good step in the right direction and something that hadn't been done in the past. So yeah, certainly I think the groundwork is there for us to continue to build on that next year.
And I think it was a very positive meeting. The fact is that we were always willing to go and speak with the Berkley selectmen and had been actually really discouraged from doing so in the past. So I think you've opened that door, Ms. Larabee, to a better line of communication with the Berkley selectmen.
As a former finance committee member.
And finally, the third goal, to develop a multi-year strategic plan. We do have a strategic planning subcommittee as well.
I think the future search was monumental to this goal. While we haven't developed a strategic plan, and I'd like to see, and thank you, Robin, for circulating the results to the attendees. I know that I had a couple of people say to me they were going to see the report, so thank you for doing that. That was a large undertaking, and it's going to be the foundation, but I would like to see us come up with a plan on how we're going to develop the strategic plan moving forward. But I do see the future search as a major accomplishment towards this goal.
Right, and we have set a goal of having the strategic plan completed by the end of the calendar year, and I believe Mr. Schoonover is working on kind of establishing a process and a working group to keep that going. The future search event was the beginning, and we just need to keep the momentum going.
Mm-hmm. I have one question on number two, where it said provide multiple opportunities. And obviously, future search was a huge opportunity to receive information and input from key stakeholder groups. But have we envisioned something else too?
We did the surveys.
Oh,
to parents,
okay.
Students. Who am I missing? What other?
We did parents, students, and staff. I will also, in the coming weeks, be having two presentations, one here and one at Berkley Middle. I've contacted Mr. Lynch and Mrs. Hebert to try to figure out what night I can go there, so that I could present the executive summary to them, some of the parent and student data that we've received, and then just to solicit more feedback from them, either on those key points or some other things that they feel might be missing.
Did you like change my number?
Just leave it. Can you change his number?
With an asterisk.
I believe we've seen the results of the teacher surveys. We actually have that on the agenda of a past meeting, or do I just remember seeing the results?
That was at a strategic planning
subcommittee meeting.
Subcommittee.
So there are some interesting results of that survey. Perhaps we should put it on the agenda at some time, have a brief presentation on it.
I think we were planning on trying to gather all that survey information and kind of make a presentation, kind of walk the entire committee through that process. Along with the future search, we can walk through that again.
Why don't we try to come up with a date, not necessarily at our last meeting, but trying to come up with a date when we will do that, so that information will be out there. It'd be interesting. I don't believe that we've seen the results of the student survey, so it'd be interesting to see that. Okay. So under unfinished business, we have the SOLA proposal. Project update.
So we had, at our last meeting on April 6th, we had Matt Short Sleeves here from Select Energy to discuss the letter of intent to move forward with the first proposal that he had spoke about at Berkley Middle School a while ago. That letter of intent has been signed at this point to allow Select to move forward with some preliminary engineering studies. The regional school district has no financial obligation at this point until we have the rate that Select is willing to enter into the power purchase agreement with us. I've done some due diligence with our solar legal counsel to make sure that we can get out at any time. I don't want to move into something unless it's financially beneficial to the school district. So we're still waiting on that. That first proposal will generate approximately 350,000 kilowatts. We use approximately 2 million a year. So we'll have, you know, some savings. Basically, the way that works is they're behind the meter credits, and we would just absorb any generation that is on those solar panels. The rate that currently is in the power purchase agreement is 7.5 cents per kilowatt. Currently, we're paying 9.65 cents per kilowatt plus distribution plus delivery fees from National Grid. So we would have some savings for those 350,000. In my mind, it's a little bit of a great thing. We don't really have any risk. They would own the panels. We just get the benefit of a cheaper rate. So that's the first proposal. The second proposal, after speaking with Matt in length about it, we've decided to kind of put the brakes on. If we moved forward with the two proposals simultaneously, it could trigger an impact study, which would cost the district approximately $20,000. And it would delay the project about 60 days. So right now, there's no rush to do both at the same time. I'd like to do the first phase first, and then we can revisit it at the end of the summer once the panels are installed. They've talked to me about putting a kiosk in the building so that the students can tie it into curriculum, which would be great for the science students who are interested in that. So that's where we're at currently.
And I know the last time Matt was here, there was some discussion about whether or not there was going to raise the cap, so I guess that has gone through and we have the letter of intent.
We do have the letter of intent. The caps have been raised, but until I see a contract with a 7.5 cent rate on it, I'm not doing anything on behalf, and I will bring it to the school committee before I do sign that. So.
Okay. Do you have any estimate as to when you'd be comfortable to accept that rate? Is that just something that you're kind of at the mercy of the market?
Kind of at the mercy, but he did kind of indicate that it would be before the end of the school year. So again, we are kind of at the mercy, but it's a good thing. I mean, when you can save $20,000 to $25,000 in utilities, it's a good thing. So I'm excited about it. Thank
you. Well, didn't he, after the legislation was actually passed, didn't he say that he expected that they would be able to do the 7.5 cents?
They did, but I haven't heard concrete on that just yet, so I will follow back up with them again, and we'll lock in as soon as we can. I mean, but it is being moved. They do have people coming and looking at the roof and everything. It is happening at this point, but.
Well, I'm not particularly happy with his subsequent email essentially discouraging the second aspect of the project. Tell you the truth, when he was here at our meeting, he made it sound like it was quite doable, and then once the letter was signed, he sort of pulled the rug out from under that second aspect of the project, and I don't like that kind of dealing, quite honestly, but I guess it's not enough to walk away from the first part of the project. I just
He's not eliminating the second proposal. We're just delaying it at this point. It's not concrete.
Delaying it, you know, part of the economy of the installation is to do it all at the same time, rather than come back and do a second installation. So, and he had a whole series of excuses as to why he didn't want to go forward with the second part of the project, which he really didn't talk about when he was here. So, but that's just my reaction to it. I think we got kind of a sales pitch, which wasn't totally candid, but anyway.
Okay. we can stop.
No, I'm not saying we should stop. I'm just saying I have reservations about the way it was presented.
Were we aware of the possibility of an impact study when he was here?
He did mention, he did say that if we did both of them together, it would cost between 15 and 20,000, which is exactly.
I don't remember him saying that we were going to be paying for that impact study.
We would be.
Maybe he did, but maybe he's saying that now, but I don't remember him saying that. Did you pay for the impact? I suppose you did pay for the impact study for the elementary schools because you were paying for the.
Well, it was part of the project. Borrego took care of that, as part of the project manager. As part of the whole project in total.
Right, we but had this way this was presented to us was it wasn't going to cost us anything. So I had certainly assumed that if there was going to be an impact study to do the second half of the project, there was going to be part rolled into the calculation of what the energy cost would be, and not that we would be putting a $15,000 to $20,000 upfront charge.
I just remember him having hesitation in doing the larger project on if the town had the capacity to take on, that type of energy. I just remember him being somewhat hesitant, and I thought he was pushing the smaller project from the get-go. That was my impression.
So do we need to take any specific action tonight on that, or do we wait until we have the final proposal and then approve it?
I would prefer to do that.
Next, under unfinished business, subcommittee reports, and we put a report from the policy subcommittee on because I wasn't sure if it was going to be a need to address a specific policy related to ALICE. What does that acronym stand for?
Alert, lockdown.
Inform,
counter, and evacuate.
Okay, so we were told that it's not necessary for us to act on that immediately, but as I mentioned to our subcommittee chair, I think it's something that should come before the committee. I don't think it's just something that should be pulled back. We're responsible for approving all policies, so we should take a look at it at some point.
On behalf of the students, I would say something with that, that you bring up ALICE, is we haven't had any training whatsoever with that. The students couldn't tell you what ALICE stands for on top of that. And with everything around the world, it'd be extremely important we have something in place. So at the end of the year, it was shelter in place, and we transitioned that. We're doing the ALICE, but we have yet to practice it. And I know there was stuff with the police department coming in, and they do training. But there isn't one time we've had a drill. And so we've had the lockdown where it's you stay in the classroom. But there's been schools in the area that have had mock drills, where I think it's extremely important that we do that. And I've actually been approached by many students, so I'd be neglecting my job as class president to bring it here. But they're like, John, what do we do? Like, what does this actually mean? And I can tell you for a fact that the majority of students and teachers, for that matter, don't even know what ALICE stands for. And I'm among that group. I know ALERT is in there, but I'm among that group. So I think the information needs to be more widespread with school security policies on that.
Thank you.
So currently for the next meeting, which will happen on May 3rd at 6:30, we do have other matters. Mm-hmm. Would we like to put that in for other matters as well, since it's already been posted? Okay. Mm-hmm. We'll do that.
Okay, good. And so now we turn to the Tri-District Subcommittee and the Regional Planning Board proposal, which we saw at the last meeting that we had, and we decided to defer action until tonight.
We had a couple members missing, so I want to make sure we gave everyone ample time to look at it. Just to give you a brief review, our subcommittee went through the regional agreement. We looked at other agreements for other regions throughout the state and made some initial changes or proposals for initial changes. They fall into the category of general updates, which really just update the agreement and take out any language that is no longer relevant, such as the interim committee, the interim period, the appointments and elections that had to be staggered in Somerset because we were just starting, now they're already staggered. So it also eliminated the language regarding the location of the school being in part of the district of Somerset, which at the time it was the building was sold to the district. That no longer applies. So those are the changes that we made under general, and they're not yet made, they're just changes that we're bringing forth for consideration. The second part was more school committee policies and practices, and really went through some changes, such as in the appointment and election. We know that many of our appointees from the K-8 districts have served for more than one term, so we figured, well, let's just make it 1 to 2 years to provide some continuity. We changed the language, or we're proposing that we change the language in regards to the vacancy of elected members, that they be filled by appointment by both this regional committee and the selectmen, rather than the former school committee, because when it was written, there was no regional school committee, so we changed that, or proposing that we change it. And the transportation language we changed because we wanted it to reflect our current policy, and we only provide transportation to students in excess of 1 mile. So we changed that. The last change that we're proposing is that we keep referring to our first budget or first draft budget as preliminary, yet in agreement it refers to as tentative. So to eliminate that confusion. But what I just want to explain once again, while we went through and really did a lot of research on what we should change and what we should keep, we're holding off on any full recommendations for changing the agreement, because we think that there's a larger discussion that needs to be had as to the structure. Before we go any further with that, we looked into what the process was for reviewing that regional structure and reviewing the, really just looking at how it's worked and going forward. And we thought the best way to do that would be to establish a regional group. And so the second part of the report is really recommending to this committee for consideration the establishment of a regional planning board. Our recommendation was that we look at having 8 members total, a little larger than what the first committee was. Could be larger. It's a lot of work from someone who sat on that committee. We want to keep the membership, 4 members from each town, and we want to make sure we represent both K-8 school committees on it. Because we've already done some work and have done a lot of research on existing agreements, we thought it would be prudent to keep the 3 members of the Tri-District Collaboration Subcommittee on that regional planning board, and we also want to include both superintendents as ex officio members. So we've outlined here a suggested appointment process for this committee to consider. We can discuss it and change it, whatever it is, maybe it includes having the full regional committee review letters of intent, and the letters will include the following information: applicant's background, explanation of their interest in participating in the process, and also a description of the time of their availability, because we're looking to do this hopefully in a year, perhaps more, and so it is a very time-intensive process. Following the approval of the regional school committee, letters of interest will be accepted. Those dates obviously now have to change. I would suggest just given the timeline of where we are now and our next meeting, that we open the process, if the committee so chooses, beginning tomorrow, so it would be April 29th, and giving a full 3 weeks for people to get in their letters by May 20th. And at that point, those letters can be reviewed. And then we'll probably be adjusting the study timeline to begin, obviously, in June. So are there any questions? I know many of you had a chance to look at that last time, but if there are any questions, if you've had a chance to digest it or looking at it for the first time.
Julie,
I think you may have said it, but just to confirm, so for the letters of interest, it would be the full school committee to agree upon who the makeup of the planning board will be?
You know, that's interesting, because I thought that the discussion was that it was going to be the tri-district, but it's, I'm reading it here, it says full regional. Does anybody correct me?
That's what we discussed with the tri-district.
Yeah.
That was my understanding.
So I apologize for that. It was, and we put it in the hands of, and this is again our suggestion, put it in the hands of the tri-district committee, because we kind of already have a sense of what has to be done. Our recommendation would still be brought to this full committee, but that was the thought process. But it still has to be approved by the full committee.
Yeah, I would not be inclined to agree to have the subcommittee designate the full membership, particularly since they're proposing to designate themselves as three members of the committee. So it's just my thought. An initial review and recommendation is fine, but
right,
I don't think
right.
that.
Yeah, I think that's what we were looking for, would be an initial review and recommendation. Yeah. But I think that the full committee could look at everything and see it and give feedback as well.
See, I think it should be open to be chosen on this board, open it to the Berkley School Committee, open it to the K-8, and that's so we can make sure the process of people being chosen is being viewed at from all the school committees. And then going forward, that's fine. But I think at least the process of choosing the people should be looked at on both committees, on K-8, so we don't run into the same problems as we did in the past. That maybe it's just people that have chosen that's pro doing the regionalization versus, I just like to see a diversity of people on it. So I like to take that out of the equation so people don't think they were handpicked for people either pro or against it. So if we open up to the K-8 on Berkeley and K-8 at Somerset, and we're all part of the process of choosing the people, at least it's not just targeted from the tri-district where some people might think the tri-district is being formulated to go regional, which I do not believe that's the case. We should definitely do it for information.
Right.
But I think the process of choosing people needs to be open, or at least invited, for the K-8 committees on both sides.
Well, the process according to Mass General Laws is according to what's written in the regional agreement. That's so. Let's go step take a step back. In the past, before there was a region, each school committee had to propose to the town meetings that they establish a regional planning board. The letters of interest were not chosen by the school committees. They were chosen by the town moderators in each town. And the town moderator in Berkeley selected three people, the town moderator in Somerset selected three people. Those three people came together and formed the regional planning board. Now that there's a region already in existence, if there's no specific language written in our agreement, which there isn't, on how to form this board, it falls to the discretion of this regional school committee. So it is the purview of this whole, it doesn't have to be the tri-district committee alone, but this whole school committee can make those appointments. And on this school committee, there are members of both K-8.
And I think we should formally notify the
K-8
committees in each town that we are forming a regional planning board, assuming that that's the vote, and that we're looking to include one member of each of the K-8 committees on the regional planning board.
Yes.
And leave it to them to decide whether they're going to designate a person or they're going to allow whoever wants to apply, and then we'll have to make a decision, I suppose.
I did make an announcement at our last school committee meeting, K-8 school committee meeting in Berkeley, that we were discussing this and the potential for the formation of the regional planning board was imminent.
I think Melissa, you brought up a good point. When we established this, it really is for information, because having done it the first time and knowing all the data that has to be looked at, I don't know what the end game is going to be, what the pros and cons. So I think that that's important to stress, that this will be a study, a very intense study of, you know, how it's worked, how it can continue to work, what are the pros and cons of different types of formations, and how we should proceed going forward. So I think for the sake of having a complement of people who have sat in the seats and have done the work and know it, and having an outside perspective, that's why we were suggesting a group of eight that had a combination of both. I mean, it could be another number, it could be 10, it could be more, but that was our, this is where we were coming from.
My other couple of questions is one, I know you've said, and it says it here, it's going to be a very, most likely, lengthy, intense process. So, I mean, how, that doesn't sound very inviting for other people to be part of it. And then I also am concerned about the superintendents being part of this, which they need to be, but that's a lot of extra time on them besides already doing the regular meetings. Is something going to change as far as having a regional meeting once these meetings start? Because that is putting a lot on our administration, and I really think there's a lot of other things that can be focused on. This is important, but you're saying how intense it is, and it's really a deterrent for people to apply for it who are already serving on multiple boards. And so I'm a little concerned about that. So there must be a way of scheduling things that can work for administration, for the people, so we can invite them to be part of this. So I hope we can keep that in mind. And lastly, we did talk about the appointment election process at the K-8 meeting. So you seem to explain it a little better than when it was read, because from some K-8 members, they thought you wanted, or the tri-district wanted, someone for at least 2 years. Oh. And we wanted to, some members said they would never agree to that.
Right.
So it should be every year. I think it should be a max that you serve 2 consecutive years. I don't think you should serve 3 consecutive, you know, take a break, like that's what I'm doing, because it really is not, it doesn't serve our K-8 or our students by just having the same people on the region, because mm-hmm. they do not see a vision of where it's going with the high school. And that's the one thing that's probably negative about being regionalized, because before it was a K-12, mm-hmm. and now you don't see the vision if it's the same people enabling from other people from doing it. You need to have a 2-year maximum, but every year you could be chosen. Because someone might come on and they're not doing well, and maybe someone else wants to step into that. So I think it should be a 2-year max at the same time. Take a break, let someone else do it, so you can have, I think that will help with communication too, because it won't just look like those are just people that are on that board. Everyone has to be part of the process.
Well, we left it 1 to 2 years, again, but these are only, we're not, we thought it made sense to show you what work we've done, but none of this is, the whole regional planning board is going to look at it again. So there will be the opportunity to make a different amendment to that. Does that answer your question?
Now, I have some somewhat different view of that issue, Melissa. I think the committee should be looking at the issue of whether a K-8 member from both communities should be on the regional school committee. I think I welcome the input, but I think it's created a huge burden for the members of the K-8 committees to attend two committee meetings and actively participate in subcommittees. It's a huge obligation, and I just happened across the statute today. I wasn't looking for it, but I was looking for something else, which indicates who can serve on a regional school committee. And there's nothing in the statute that requires that K-8 school committee member be served on a regional committee. I think the vast majority of regional school districts are K-12 districts anyway, but so it's not really an issue, but not an issue to be decided tonight, obviously.
In our agreement.
It is in our agreement, because it's already came up, Mr. Schoonover had said, and I had said the last meeting for people, and maybe this is a deterrent, I don't know, but when you run for K-8, you need to know you most likely will have a turn on the region, so just apply and run for office, and you have no intentions of running, helping out in the region. That's why I think it's fair And again, I understand it's difficult on the region to have different people coming. I understand that. But it is about bringing that voice and that vision to see what's going on for the future. I think that is the real purpose of it. And to bring back and to communicate with the rest
of the. Well, that's why it was written in the agreement originally. But I think any time we're going to look, our committee held back from making any substantial recommendations for change. Because once you hit that, any substantial changes, it really should be done by a regional planning board that includes outside input. So we just wanted to show you that we haven't been twiddling our thumbs. We have been looking at things. You know, we've been researching what other agreements have look like. And these are the things that are pretty obvious to make. You know, the language changes are pretty obvious to make. But we think before we go any further, we need to establish a regional planning board that includes both outside input as well as school committee input to go further.
Just two quick thoughts on this issue. The first one is I think it's invaluable to have members of the KDA committee serve on the high school. I think the perspective that we can bring back and forth serving on the two committees is very useful. And secondly, I'm not a huge fan of putting any kind of cap on how many years you can serve as an appointed member. I do agree with you that the intent of having turnover and having different voices and different people on the committee is useful. But I do think that if someone is willing to serve and to put themselves, as Mr. Peirce said, in the place to be in two different meetings every month and all the subcommittee meetings, if someone's willing to do that, there shouldn't be a deterrent in place to prevent them from doing it, especially when you're the one from Berkeley and you're the only unpaid member of the group. So.
Well, I wouldn't. I'd like to find a way to leave that open, but. There's also the concern that in a five-member committee, particularly on the, I think more on the Somerset side, finding two members of a five-member committee who are willing to serve could become problematic in the future. So I'm just raising that issue as another thing that the committee might look at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The more pressing issue that I'd like to at least raise is the number of people on the committee, and obviously you don't want it to become unwieldy, but I am concerned that limiting the number to eight, particularly on the Somerset side, if we're talking about including the tri-district committee, which is already two members from Somerset, We do have the issue of the reorganization of our committee coming up before this committee is appointed, and who will be serving on this committee and who will be the K-8 representatives and how we would address that, which could possibly leave the number of community members, particularly from Somerset, at a very low number. So.
Is it sensible to change it to 8 to 10 and then see what applications we have come through? That would add another body from each community.
And I would think that they would be enough for.
Oh, yeah, no, absolutely.
No, 10 was the number that I was, you don't want it to become unwieldy. But
so why don't we 8 to 10? That way we can see what applications we get and see what demand and what interest there is.
Can I just ask, does it need to be an even number? Just is there going to be any voting in place? You might end up with ties. Like, you might want an odd number, just in case.
Well, does it have to be an equal number from each community?
No, we thought.
The intent was is that we would have equal representation for both communities.
Yeah.
I'm
just thinking, is going to be any voting taking place? Like, if you're going to make some decisions, if you have an even number, who's going to be the tiebreaker?
Well, once again, the committee reports back to us
right.
With their recommendations, and we, this odd-numbered group, ultimately.
We're hoping
that
there might not be a majority.
No, but we're hoping that it fosters kind of an intention to reach consensus as much as possible. So when you don't have that tiebreaker, it's not simply by the numbers; it's how are we going to get the majority.
Additionally, too, there's no practical way to have an odd number without having one community more or less represented.
Yeah. So that was kind of all we can do, but I wouldn't be opposed to the 10, I think.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
Sure.
Am I there? I was thinking the same thing.
So, and we could, if we do increase it to 10, it would be the same breakdown. And does anybody have an issue with the expanded time to reply? So it would be essentially 3 weeks. We'd be looking, we would, if the committee approves it, we could put something in the paper, send out something to paper in the cable stations as early as tomorrow, and say that we're accepting letters of interest through May 20th. I looked at that date because it would give us enough time before our next school committee meeting to actually approve that. Because I think we have a committee meeting on the 26th.
Yes.
So.
So what day is the 20th? Is that a Friday?
Yes.
It's a Friday.
The thing is, you're putting this out tomorrow, and I just think it'd be a little more time to put exactly how many hours this might entail. You know, so you're putting it out, and people are going to apply them, and you might say, you need 20 hours a week. I don't know. That'd be, hey, I can't do that. So maybe just something to think about to put in the paper for next week and have a meeting to say, what hours are we looking for? What commitment? What days? Because it's going to be hard to apply if you're like, I meet every Wednesday night, and somebody might say, I work every Wednesday. So
we want to be flexible on that because we want to see what nice people are available to participate if they wish to participate.
When we formed the building committee, and I remember when we sat on that, when we organized and we had the letter of intent, I remember distinctly from the building committee, we hadn't even set on a date. So I think that that can be figured out as once the group organizes that first meeting as far as what they're available to do.
When there's 10 people sitting in our room, we're going to say, okay, what's the best date? What's the best, typically, is it Tuesdays, is it Thursdays? So I would hate to impose that on that committee without having
right, well, at least have the hours that it might take for a week.
Well, we're figuring, we were talking about one, either bi-weekly or weekly meetings.
I mean, the one thing that when we, I think Stephanie would agree, when we applied for the building committee, they did give us the very daunting task to say that we plan to be on this committee for 3 to 5 years, right?
Five years.
So they told us it was that long a commitment. I think we can tell them that, everyone, that if we can expect it'll be at least a year to a year and a half commitment.
We're hoping a year.
Depending on how fast it works. And I think that that's reasonable given the trend doing regional studies has been about 18 months.
Well, also given the economic situation in both communities, the sooner the better. Yeah.
So
I
when
say that's intense, but I don't know, we can't determine.
Just because I'd like to give people as much time as possible to apply, when would you think, if our meeting is on the 26th, when would you think that you would try to schedule a tri-district committee meeting on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday? I'm wondering if we could give people until noontime on the 23rd, just so they have the weekend.
Is that the holiday?
Well, the 30th could be the holiday.
Well, we could say until...
I'm not sure.
We could possibly meet on the 24th. Is anybody on? Do we have a building committee meeting on the 24th? We could get it the whole weekend. That would give it a little bit more time.
That's fine.
So we could say the 24th. I mean the 23rd.
I have a quick question. So since the full region's going to review the letters of interest, so would people send their letters of interest to the full board so all the emails would be included at that time if people want to do it via email?
Well,
I think they should be sent to the
superintendent
office.
And then everybody will get
to our recording, to our recording secretary.
Right.
She loves for us to give her more work to do.
And Jeff likes emails.
She's smiling.
So is that, So we can extend it to from April 29th through May 23rd. And is everyone okay with the idea of having?
So 23 is Memorial Day, or isn't it?
No,
do we know that Memorial Day is?
23rd. That's Victoria Day. 23rd.
29th is Memorial Day? All right, well, that's good then.
Yep.
Do we want to make it noon on the 23rd?
Or? You can just make it by 4 o'clock.
All right, 4 p.m. on the 23rd.
Is it sensitive to you to say that we'll try to have a meeting with the committee the first week in June?
We would hope so. Well, that we can put out there, too. We could have it by the beach or something, summer meetings.
Peirce
Beach, I think. With the community spots. So is that, we will try to have a tri-district meeting to provide a preliminary review of those letters on the 25th so that everyone can, we can provide a recommendation to everybody on the 26th.
Right. So it says in the last bullet here, the final report to be submitted to the Regional School Committee for consideration and recommendation by May 2017. Now, that's really too late to be on an annual town meeting warrant in either community. So I'm just wondering that, but there's no flexibility built into that sentence, so I don't know.
So how about if we say this in the spring of 2017? I mean, the goal is to have it done by then, but we were trying to give a full year. I don't know what you think.
Again, it's a study. We wanted to be able to have the time to do it, but also to have something done by March or April. We were concerned that it would be rushed. So, you know, to Ms. Gagliardi's point, if we say to, you know, we can present something to the committee in the spring or no later than May, you know, that.
What do you think?
Well, I was thinking that was a reasonable timeline. On Tuesday, when we were on the Hill, Mr. Peirce and I met with two members from the Dayton-Rehoboth School Committee, and they began, granted, their work is different in reviewing their regional agreement. They haven't looked at it in many years, so they have different challenges through that process, but they've been involved in this already for, I would say, about a year or so, and I was asking how close they were to the end, and I don't think the end is really in sight right now. So I was immediately thinking about this, but they're looking at the whole funding formula, so they have different challenges right now, but just listening to them, I was thinking about this process and wondering if we're being too ambitious, but.
What I recall them saying is they're either this close to a final resolution or this close to a final resolution, and they're not quite sure which applies, so. I don't know. How about if we say consideration and recommendation by May of 2017, unless extended by the regional school committee, something like that, so that if the committee really feels it needs some additional time, they can request it.
Can I just say I support. Let's just go over on this, because if we look at our goals and how we rate ourselves, we do tend to be very ambitious, and we're not really superseding or meeting the goals that we need. We should be getting fours across the board. We should be making goals that we can attain. And I don't like to set up for failure. And I'm just saying that I think May is a little too quick. I think in looking at other things, that just how far we've gotten, we didn't do really great on our self-assessment as it is. And these are goals that we put in place. that we agreed to, and we really just started this process. So maybe we need to think about, again, the time with the administration to be part of it. It's going to put extra pressure on them as well. Maybe something that, maybe a preliminary report on the May.
How about remove the word final?
Right.
Or how about a progress report final to be submitted to the region?
Progress report, something that doesn't have a lot of pressure just in case things.
Well, the only thing is there needs to be work done initially to get kind of a perspective on what direction this is going to head in, I think. And to figure out the feasibility of making major decisions like adding one or more K-8 districts to the regional school district. If it becomes clear early on or midway that that's not a likely prospect, then I think this work should be wrapped up in here. If it becomes more complicated, then it may take longer, but I think we should be trying to move it along as quickly as possible. I think there are reasons why this work should be done as promptly as possible. Fiscal 18 is going to be a challenge, I think, in both communities. There are certain fiscal benefits to further regionalization in terms of, regional transportation aid is just one factor. It would be a very significant additional revenue to the Somerset K-8 district, since they have a multi-million-dollar transportation budget. If they were getting 60, 70, 75% of that reimbursed, that would take a lot of financial pressure off. I'm not jumping to any conclusions. I'm just making these observations that those are the initial, issues that should be looked at. And if the conclusion is that it's just not feasible or doable at this time, then I think the rest of the work can be done pretty quickly.
I hear that. I just think it's a little quick. I mean, we just started in this new school. I think people are still healing from the regionalization in the first spot. I just feel like bringing this up so quickly, again, Dayton Hope, it's been regionalized for how long? There's other places that have not moved as quickly as we are. Why are we pushing it to that point?
It's in our agreement that after 5 years.
Right, but we don't need to have this done by May.
So, well, no, but I think that what we can say is, how about if we say a report to be submitted to the regional school committee for consideration and recommendation by May 2017?
I mean, I like to see us get to other goals, the strategic planning and other things, get those things complete, and then more.
But this is really a focus on this particularly, this unique group of people we're going to work, really concentrate on.
Yeah, and we need to do a strategic plan for the high school, regardless of where this goes, I think.
I'm just trying to be realistic because, I mean, I like to get people that are in the community that work full-time jobs. I want to be part of it, not just people that are not working or retired or have time or, I want to bring up the diversity of people, and you're just adding a lot of stuff, strategic planning, this, all at once. We just started this high school. We need to go back to level one. There's so many other things I think we need to focus on. I don't mind starting this discussion. I just would like a process that people can be part of.
The economic realities in both communities won't wait for us to look at this over a period of a number of years. So I think that it is important that we get this started as soon as we can. And we'll have to roll with it as the process is going along. I think it's impractical to set a number of deadlines and goals. As Mr. Peirce was saying, there's a possibility that we'll begin this process and realize that it's not workable. And then we'll have to look at other ways to address the economic needs of both communities. But I agree with you that it would be great if we had a lengthy process that could go over a number of years to address this, slowly.
Well,
year,
just a little more.
Yeah, but I think the economic realities of both communities, we have to be responsible and look at this as part of the potential solution.
Yeah. And that was one of the main topics of our tri-district committee is to continuously look to see how we can possibly save money as a dual community and to see if it makes sense to move forward or not. So I think we would be remiss to say we're not going to take a look at it and we have that plan. So I agree with you.
I understand. I just like to, the more stuff that we ask, the less community involvement we're probably going to get because people can only do so much.
I know.
That's all
speaking,
I'm saying.
Just speaking for myself, I, you know.
We ask for the future search, but we did that all the time and yes. Now we have something else.
I was going to comment when Mr. Larabee talked about the willingness to serve on two committees.
Right.
Yeah. He hasn't, his wife has only endured this for a matter of months. So. She may have something to say down the line about serving on two committees that is compelling.
So we'll leave it, I think, just to give some flexibility if we say a report, because I think we do want to have some update at some point. And that will give some flexibility to where we stand. It could be a report that's done fairly quickly because we know it's not going anywhere, or it may require more. The report could say we need more time. But at least if we say a report to be submitted to the Regional School Committee for consideration and possible recommendations by May 2017. I think that covers all possible scenarios.
It's a one-year report, and what has transpired in the 1 year, if it has to be carried forward, it's carried forward. Because
right.
Some people might be shocked to think, well, this is going to happen in a year.
It's
got to alleviate that. Got to get them on board.
Does it make sense to have it be no later than May 2017, just in case we're done in January?
Sure.
Yeah, no later. That's fine.
The sooner the better.
The glass half full kind of person is the Larabee.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think we've been through all of the provisions, and I'm just going to read through this. As the final, the Regional Planning Board, number one, make up 10, up to 10 members total, 5 members from each town, no more than 5 members from each town, and representation of both K-8 school committees, 3 members of the Tri-District Collaboration Subcommittee, and 7 community members. Both superintendents will be ex officio members of the RPB. Appointment process, full regional committee will review letters of interest. Letters will include the following information: applicant's background, explanation of interest in participating in the process, description of applicant's availability to participate in the 10 to 12 month review and study. Following approval of the regional school committee, letters of interest will be accepted beginning April 29th through May 23rd. Mm-hmm. The Tri-District Collaboration Subcommittee will review applicants and by a majority vote make the
recommend appointments.
Recommendations. For appointments of community members to the Regional Planning Board.
Mm-hmm.
Study time frame, Regional Planning Board will begin meeting in June of 2016. A report to be submitted to the Regional School Committee for consideration and recommendation. We
said possible recommendations no later than May 2017.
Oh, there. For possible recommendations?
Right.
Report and possible.
Because if they don't.
Okay, so the final bullet, a report. And possible recommendations to be submitted to the Regional School Committee for consideration and recommendation no later than May 2017. So I'll entertain a motion to adopt that proposal for a Regional Planning Board with all of the provisions which we just went through.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Ghilarducci and seconded by Mrs. Field. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
And if I may, for 1 second, sorry to interject, I do have to run. I apologize, but I do want to thank you for the opportunity to actually come here, give you a perspective and listen in, and take notes on some interesting things going on in the school that I can bring back to the students. Apologize, it's kind of a little early. Well, I know you guys could be going until midnight this evening, but I just wanted to thank you again before. And
well, thank you, John.
Thank you.
Congratulations, John.
Okay, so the next item we have on the agenda is amendment of Somerset fiscal year 17 assessment. This was on the agenda, but it is an issue. We became aware that the selectmen voted on a warrant article last night that actually does not reflect the amount of the assessment that we certified to them as Somerset's assessment for FY17. Apparently, the reason for the discrepancy in the amount that was included in the warrant article, and I really don't know whether the warrant is absolutely finalized at this point or not. I don't know if we know that with certainty, but apparently the Board of Selectmen deducted an additional
$80,000
even? Mm-hmm. That's not, I mean, the number isn't 80,000 even. It's
70,000.
Not in our agreement, it's 80,000 and change.
Yeah, this is
80,400. Okay. Yeah. On the premise that they would be providing us with cable funding for that was received in the current fiscal year, as well as money that will be received in fiscal 17. We had made a decision that we were going to create a revolving fund, and any monies that we received this year would be deposited in the revolving fund, spent in 2017, and the credit would be applied to the Somerset assessment in 17, that any funds that came in 17 would be deposited in the revolving account, and a credit would be applied to the fiscal 18 assessment. The flaw in the process that the selectmen use without really consulting with our budget committee is that it leaves us $80,000 short in revenue for our operating budget, because the $80,000 that they're proposing to take an additional credit for is earmarked for educational programming. And we have budgeted for the educational programming based upon the $70,000 we were going to receive. We don't expect to spend $150,000 on educational programming next year. And that revenue that they've deducted is for other purposes. So it will leave us short, because the money that they're providing to us from the cable license agreement is specifically earmarked for educational programming. So I don't believe that, first of all, I don't believe the selectmen had authority to change our assessment. The statute is absolutely clear. They can vote down our assessment, but they can't change the amount. So I think we really should notify the selectmen of the issue and be prepared to address it at the town meeting, but
the budget
reducing the assessment is going to leave us short.
We discussed this at the budget subcommittee prior to this meeting, and we discussed it with the business manager and the superintendent, as well as yourself. And but we feel it would be important for us to notify the Board of Selectmen via letter and also attend their next meeting, whenever that is, or request to be on our agenda, so that we can explain clearly how this affects us and how it clearly can't be done. So with the full committee's approval, that's how we want to proceed with it.
All right. So, I don't think we need, that's the
consensus,
and that's the way we'll proceed.
Okay.
Do you want us all there?
Pardon?
Do you want us all there?
No. I mean, you're certainly welcome to come, but no, it won't be necessary.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, I'm not sure if there is when the next selectman's meeting would be. There's probably one.
It's the first Wednesday and the third Wednesday of each month. That's what it's normally scheduled as. So May 4th? Is that
yeah,
Wednesday?
Maybe next week.
Yeah, next Wednesday.
Okay. But I thought they just met last
they
night.
Had an extra one.
Okay.
Good going, Laura.
Can I see? Are you going to ask people on the agenda or just show up?
No,
we'll notify them of that of the concern we have and ask to be there. Okay, so the next item on the agenda is the establishment of a television studio revolving fund, and this relates to how we anticipated using the money, which I've described. We have received a check for funds that were received under the license agreement in fiscal 16, and but not all of the money under the agreement. It's still about $20,000, a little more than $20,000 short.
Mm-hmm.
So the way we expected to handle this was that we'd receive the money, deposit it in a revolving account, and then spend it in fiscal 17 and give the town of Somerset a credit for that amount on the fiscal 17 assessment. That's what we did. So we need to establish a revolving account into which we can deposit these funds as we receive them and then expend them for educational programming during the course of the year. So I'll entertain a motion to establish a television studio revolving account.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mr. Larabee. Any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. All right, next is town meeting presentation.
So we have, the committee also reviewed a proposal for a town meeting presentation. We edited it down with the understanding that we want to make it as brief as possible. So there will be, I think we ended up with, Lindsay, what, four slides, basically? Just to explain the trends in funding for the school district to give voters as much information as possible on how we've been funding the school district. So we have that information. I think you have a copy in your packet. So we're going to keep some of the information is repetitive, so we are going to keep the very first slide. The second slide we're not going to have. We're keeping the third slide. And the next three slides, Berkeley's total contribution, Chapter 78 trends and regional transportation will be combined into one slide. There'll be one slide for the operating assessment, and that will be it.
We
One of the things the budget subcommittee talked about was, I know you have the full presentation in your packet, but it was decided to trim that down, as Mrs. Gagliardi said, for the purpose of the presentation. But there will be additional information in the form of appendix within that PowerPoint slide if there are any questions from the floor.
And obviously, the presentation can be succinct, but we will be prepared to answer any questions that anyone at the town meeting may have with respect to our budget. I think we're not doing this to discourage any questions anyone might have, because we're comfortable and confident about our budget.
We don't have a similar presentation for Berkeley, because their town meeting structure is quite different, so they don't have that opportunity. But we will have representation at the Berkeley. Mm-hmm.
We always do. Yeah.
I have one question. For our budget expenses, is the special ed budget, is that the right number after the circuit breaker, after the special ed, or is that prior to our revenue census?
You mean, are you referring to the...
The pie graph.
Okay, this is what's going to be mailed to all the residents in both towns, is the annual report,
mm-hmm.
right?
It's includes circuit breaker, it's gross.
It's gross.
So that's what it is after?
No, it's before.
Why do we do that before?
The method we do for the budget, we use a gross method, which you total every expense up for all funds, and then you take revenue sources off of those to come to a net number, and that's what you base your assessments off of.
Okay, so where's the, we have somewhere the final number after the revenue sources?
Yeah, it's the chart to the right, which is your operating budget. That's in total, but it doesn't have it by category.
I think I had mentioned this, I'm not sure it was last year or the year before, because I think that's really important to put in those grants, circuit breaker, because special education has this bigger part of the pie graph, and I remember years ago, it was a lot less, because it was somehow they put in the pie graph after, because I specifically asked for it, because that's kind of a true number after you take the grants, after you take everything that you get for revenue sources, so it doesn't look like that's the biggest, chunk out of it besides salaries.
The move to putting in a group, because I remember I was on ENF, and the move to represent the gross numbers really came, I know sitting in my chair, we wanted to see, because that any number, whether it be special ed, whether it be transportation, can have an effect, it can be affected by not, if you're looking at net numbers, not just an increase in that expense, but also a change in the revenue source. So if you separate out the total gross budget expenditure and then show the revenue source, you can see where those fluctuations are happening. So we do show below that circuit breaker. You do show there's circuit breaker there, there's grant, the idea spread grant. So we do show, it's better to show them separately than it is to show a net number. Because from year to year, if a change happens that's really extraordinary, and part of it is driven by a reduction in revenue, it looks like your expenses went off.
I know you might think that's the best way, but I really feel it's not when you look at it, because that's something that has been discussed in this town and among other budgets. It's really good to see after, even if you want to go by this was last year. If you don't want to project this year, say last year this was the funds that we got, and this is how much special education costs after we received all the revenue sources. If we're going to do a historic timeline, let's put that in there, because instead it looks like that's what it is, and people don't understand that's always the problem in our budgets. It's always a problem in approval. We say, SPED is the budget buster. Let's show that there's actually money coming in when kids are being serviced.
But I think
because that's our biggest revenue. I don't think it shows in the end product.
It shows it with circuit breaker grant, it shows it with IES bed grant that goes to offset that and $180,000. It does show that there.
Where
does it
show the end total? Like when you see
1,650,000.
there should be an end number of last year, this is how much it was, and after all the revenue sources, this is how much. I like to see that, because how I would like to even know this. How much was it last year? How much was it if you started with the gross? And then how much was it at the end of the year after all the revenue sources? I think that's important to tell the people, to show this money coming back. It's not just special needs kids costing money in the district. There is money coming back from this as well.
How do you, how would we graphically show that for the other sources that aren't specifically targeted to one specific area of the budget, such as school choice revolving revenue?
You pull out a piece of the gross, and then if you did it for one, you have to do it for the others,
yeah.
And then it gets tricky for your revenue sources as to how you accurately show that. So maybe, Melissa, I don't know if maybe there's a way we could identify on the revenue sources which ones are specific for special ed. I think that community members could then go back up to the gross, and if maybe it's just not clear the revenue sources, which ones pertain to special ed.
Why can't we just add a line of this was last year, this is how much special ed was, this was our revenue sources, and this is what we ended with last year for special education, and that's a way of kind of keeping track. We can't put in a sentence of that. I think that makes a difference.
Amen on the back.
I mean, I think you can fit it in somewhere.
So you
and that's an historic timeline which reaches for our goals, showing an historic timeline of the budget. And that is always a topic of discussion. And I've been saying this for years. I get very upset when I hear it on stage. It's all special ed. That's why the budget. I'm really tired of hearing that. I don't want to hear that anymore. Let's show the people what money is coming back. That isn't our biggest budget question. It's a scapegoat. I'm sorry. And then I see that changed.
Well, it is, not to make it a scapegoat, but it is a volatile area of our budget.
Okay, so let's show last year where we started, our revenue, and where we went, and where we ended up after all the resources came in. Let's show that.
Just for special ed. So you want a special
thing? Yeah, because that's what's always talked about on stage at every budget. It was talked about at candidates night. It'll be talked about again at this to increase the budget 5.3%. It will be discussed because of special ed. So that is why this needs to be put in there. Because that's being used every single time we increase the budget.
Okay. The only concession I would make is I would identify in revenue sources which one pertain to special education.
Well, I would like to see that information, so maybe Lindsay can send it to me and I will send it to the paper. So if you don't want to put it in here, I will put it out in the media, because I want to know last year exactly where we were, revenue and the end point, and I would like that every year.
Okay, but all right, do you want it just what it was last year?
Where we started on the pie graph, where we ended, after all the revenue sources.
So you want us to take, so mm-hmm. I mean, it's basically highlighting this piece of the pie chart mm-hmm. and subtracting the ones that mm-hmm. apply and just giving a net amount.
Mm-hmm. And where we were last year. If we can't do this year because we can't project it, that's fine. But that's where people can compare of what was proposed last year and if everything's working together.
But you understand that it can change mid-year, not because it's off of budget, but mm-hmm. because a student might come in or a student might leave, right?
I understand that.
So if you compare our budget mm-hmm. to what actually happens, mm-hmm. those changes can be not because we didn't budget correctly, but because of the volatility of the...
I think there's a way of being more transparent. Then if that's the case, then I don't want to hear on stage anymore about special ed being the budget buster. I have no problem if it doesn't want to be put in here. But I don't want to hear that's always the problem without us being more transparent, more detailed about special education.
Melissa, I'm sorry, but when you go through our budget for this year and you look at what's driving the $600,000 increase, you're going to see that $300,000 could be traced back to non-reoccurring revenue. So, and then a portion of the $300,000 is changes in sped costs.
Most, so, and out of district, we get how much reimbursement? 70%.
70, I know, but what we're showing is we're showing both the change in the revenue and the change in the expenses.
70% of, are you referring to circuit breaker?
Yes.
Reimbursement? Well, yes. 70% of above the cap. Mm-hmm. So if you have a $50,000 tuition and the cap is 35, you're not getting, you know, you're not getting 70% of the mm-hmm. special ed costs. I think, Melissa, I've heard you loud and clear, and I don't think it's, I agree with you, I don't think it's fair to put the burden on special education kids. It's a fact of budgeting life that we have, and a lot of there's been a lot of discussion about how Chapter 70 underestimates special education costs. But if we wanted to do a study of what the actual cost of special education is, it's far more complicated than just these two wedges of the pie. As a matter of fact, I was going to ask this question. Does this just reflect out of district placements rather than total special education cost?
No, it includes transportation too.
Yeah, but it doesn't include salaries for special education teachers in district.
No,
those are or in district transportation costs or any of those kinds of
special education as it's categorized in the pie chart includes tuitions, transportation, and other supplies. The teachers are in the salaries line.
Right. Okay. So, and then two, Chapter 70 aid, we get more Chapter 70 aid for a special education student than we do for other students.
But it's not a count of students. It's a percentage of our population.
Right,
so we
exactly.
could have 20 out of district and they only give us 4%. So it's not.
No, but it would be a complex you know, presentation to really get down to the nitty gritty of exactly what it is.
Right. I think what we can do is if you want us to come up with a kind of breakdown of special education, I think that's something that the budget committee wants to do. I complimented Superintendent Schoonover for giving a very clear picture of the savings that can be achieved when we bring some programs in district. I think we can do a better job of making those discussions a lot clearer. But I think it's hard to do it in the context of this thing because it isn't that easy to lay out in a pie. Because if you take teachers that teach special education, they're in this part of the pie, not in the other part.
Okay.
So we can come up with another kind of document that will lay it out a little bit more clearly because we want it to be transparent. We don't want it to be confusing. I think if you're expressing the need that we need to communicate that better, that's something we should strive to do.
Too much information.
Maybe we can do a slide, once again, that we have in reserve in the event that a question arises regarding special education costs. Yeah.
I mean, I don't think there's any shame in saying, you know, I see the pie size, I see that, Melissa, but I also see the employee benefits side, too. I mean, it's the reality of what our budget is in the makeup of our student population and our teaching staff, so.
I understand the reality. It's like saying, if you said music department was a budget buster, and you're like, okay, this costs $200,000, but then we never brought up, or we didn't explain to people there was $50,000 in donations. Just look at the pie graph and subtract it. And we constantly said it was music. And we're not constantly talking about the money that goes in to actually help defray the cost. And that's where I feel like it's always brought up. And we don't really educate the people about understanding that there is money that's coming in. It's not just an expense. There's actually money that comes back. And there is grants. It's like saying music just comes in handy, just costs us, but we're dismissing all the other stuff. And that's just how I feel. I'm sorry. It's just targeting one thing, and we need to explain that a little bit more than other parts of the budget, so since that's always the discussion.
Right. I don't.
Well, did you listen to this state? Were you at the state?
I was not.
Okay. Well, I made a special effort to address special education costs and to respond to a statement by one of the selectman candidates expressing skepticism about the effort to bring students back into the district and suggesting that it really wasn't saving money. And so I made a special effort to assure people that bringing students back into the district is has a twofold benefit. One is for the benefit of the students who, in the vast majority of cases, are far better served in district than out of district, unless, of course, they have particular needs that we're unable to address within the district. And I also talked about the fact that, money aside, we have an obligation to provide an education for every kid, regardless of their needs, and that parents of special ed kids want the same thing for their kids as every other parent wants, and that it's our not only our legal obligation, but also our moral obligation to address the needs of these kids. So I think we're making every effort based upon your advocacy to blame our special kids for budget issues. You know, their needs will be addressed, just like every other student's needs will be addressed. So, I just think.
And you can understand where I'm coming from, and I appreciate you doing that, Mr. Peirce. But that is really seems like that's the only time special needs is really being the highlight of our schools. For example, when we get to the highlights of our schools. When we talk about things, if it's a DECA presentation, if it's highlights of our schools, it's nothing about special ed. The only time we talk about special ed, how many is there compared to everything else? But every year our budget is about special ed. That's all I'm saying. I have 1 year I would like to hear that's not about the budget issue.
Well, there is a specific reference in the report here about the unified basketball and track programs.
And I think we've made a very, with what we've asked for this year, to make a commitment to, you know, purchasing a van and hiring another teacher and a half a paraprofessional and our paraprofessional, and working to build programming and having this director of special education. I think we've made some really big progress to make them this more inclusive and make them part of this community. We've made a commitment to that and. I agree with you. It's hard to look at and single one group out, but I think we've put our money literally where our mouth is to say we've made a commitment to this population to bring them back into the fold, and it may just take time to dispel that.
So we can mention some of those things in next year's. We can add a bullet there about mm-hmm. the van, and this is highlighting this past year's highlights. And I think that we can look to having a presentation to the full committee because it will benefit the entire community in the future. I will kind of lay out some of the numbers that you're talking about. But we're better serving that concern by doing it in a separate presentation that really outlines it. One line is going to, I don't think it's going to do it justice. That's my opinion. Okay, thank you.
But for the purpose of the meeting, I think that having an extra slide in the appendix in the event that the question comes up and we do hear those opinions coming out, we have that at the ready to walk through that with people and clarify that.
Mm-hmm. How complicated is that to provide between now and the town meeting in May?
I've already done work on it.
Can I just say something? It just hit me a little funny when it's like we'll add that we'll put the van in. It's like saying, we're going to put in the highlights, we got a new school bus. The kids in the van don't care that they got a new van. The kids don't care we get a new school bus. It's not about that.
It shows commitment.
It does show commitment, but let's compare extracurricular activities, fun things, things that they're being promoted with. For example, DR just did a prom. It was in the, they have a best buddy program. There's a lot of other programs in other districts that we could do better. That's what I'm saying. We're starting, but I'm just saying is we're not really in the forefront with this yet. But again, it's the forefront of the budget. I just like to see that change over time and have a better understanding. Mm-hmm. That's all.
Well, I think a presentation that will kind of explain the things, that the money that comes in, the money that that's expended, talk about maybe new initiatives that might be looked at, might be another step in that direction.
You know what would be a large step in that direction too, and this is for next year, not for this year, but I think it's something that, that we should highlight, is ask each of our administrators to do a short write-up on their accomplishments for the year. So you would have technology, you would have director of special education, you'd have curriculum, and you'd have more of an holistic view of high-level strategically what we've accomplished. And then, well, it was, again, we have somebody who now is focused on special ed, and she can package that to say, this is what we've accomplished forward. So we don't just pick out, like you said, Melissa, just those few little things that we've done that may not signify what our goal is and what we're trying to do by bringing the students back in district and having them be part of the community here.
And thank you. I mean, thank you for the time. I'm only going to be, I think I only have one more meeting on the region, and then I'll have the year off, and maybe who knows, forever. I don't know. So I don't know who's going. I don't know who's going to be the voice. I'm sorry. I just wonder if there's going to be someone else that's going to step up and remember special needs and special ed as I do.
Well,
this
I
year
think,
coming up.
I think we are doing. I think that we're committed to doing that. I think what you just suggested, Stephanie, would I think please our superintendent, who feels like we don't talk enough, spend a lot of time talking about the numbers and not enough about what actually happens in these schools. So given the time constraints, this has to go out next week. We'll go out with this, but I think we'll show some commitment to doing a beefier annual report that spends more time talking about.
And you'll have a slide here. If a question comes up, as Mr. Peirce said, there'll be a slide that can be focused on and they can hear it.
This is not a slide presentation, obviously. This is what goes out. But I think we can make a commitment to try and put something a little better together for next year.
Okay. So, do we need to approve the flyer?
Yes.
All right. So, I'll entertain a motion to approve the flyer.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Rothwell and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Is there any further discussion? Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I vote yes for reservation.
Okay, so we have 6 in the affirmative, 1 affirmative vote with reservations. So this is Terra. So monthly operating invoices, does anyone have any questions about the invoices? All right, so we'll move on to building committee update, status report. We had a building committee meeting on Tuesday night the project manager reported that we're kind of in the punch list and finishing stages. We still have some site work that requires completion. We have some work that needs to be done in the boiler room. We're also expecting that the lift on the bleachers at the football stadium will be replaced because it hasn't really operated effectively from the outset, and that should be starting relatively soon. The subcontractor that's responsible for the lawn in the front is working there, fertilizing, split seeding, and doing certain patchwork. We've also authorized the closing of the wells that we drilled in the front, which did not provide sufficient quantity of water to make them worth pursuing. So we're in the process of closing those up so that the area surrounding those wells can be cleaned up and seeded. So that's, and we were also talking about the closeout of the project. We're still hoping that we'll be able to close out by sometime in August so that we can get on the agenda for the MSBA to do its audit and then close out the project in November of this year. And hopefully that will happen as long as the general contractor stays on schedule. I mentioned at the building committee meeting, and I just wanted to mention again, there have been some emails about the fact that the baseball team played its first six or seven games away because of the condition of the infield. That was strictly a failure on the part of the site subcontractor installing certain material in the infield mix. It was well beyond the responsibility of the athletic director to do that work. We had met with the general contractor many weeks ago. We'd actually provided the general contractor with a copy of the baseball schedule. They knew exactly when the first game was scheduled. They were supposed to have the material installed before the start of the season. And unfortunately, they didn't install the material until early this week. So the baseball team played its first home game on Wednesday, I believe. Was that the day of our business after hours? And they had a resounding victory to start off play on the new field. I believe they won 5-1. Is that right, George? So, and an excellent pitching performance and good hitting. So, we're very glad. And actually, I was there for a very brief period of time, although I saw most of the scoring that our team did in the short time that I was there. But I also saw Robert Souza, a former teacher at Somerset High School, who was actually a teacher of mine, but also the baseball coach here, and apparently he threw out the first ball for that game. It was very nice, but we are looking forward to the more formal rededication of the field coming up very soon. So, but I did want to make it clear for those who had expressed some concern that this was not a failure on the part of the athletic director to have that field ready. It rests solely on the back of our site subcontractor, despite significant prodding from us to get it done before the season started. So we do have the monthly invoices, and there are actually, I don't believe, any payments. There's a very small payment to Bacon Agostini for an approved change order of $1,194. There are two invoices to W.B. Mason for furniture. The file cabinet in the nursing area had been approved perhaps as long as a year ago. There was discussion about the need for confidentiality and a locked file cabinet in the nurse's office, and it had been approved by the building committee, I think, as long as when they were first moving into the building. And apparently the file cabinet only just arrived. And then one desk that was purchased, I believe, in relation to the reception area in the main office. And then the major invoice is a payment to Hub Communications as an initial payment for the engineering and equipment in the TV studio of $87,880.80, for a total this month of $92,351.80. Those invoices have all been approved by the building committee at the meeting earlier this week. And I would entertain a motion to approve the payment of $92,351.80 as detailed in the schedule that everyone has in front of them.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mrs. Rothwell. Any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Okay, next item, informational items. Chamber of Commerce business after hours on April 27th, yesterday, and the Somerset business open house on May 5th. Mrs. Gagliardi, would you report?
We had a business after hours last night. It really kicked off the Chamber's Ed Up campaign, which is the Chamber's education committee's efforts to really encourage education in the whole region. So I have some bookmarks and bracelets to hand out to the committee. You'll see some billboards going up to kind of encourage this. You'll see letters to the editor, some programs going on cable, all talking about the value of education and how it helps to bring the whole economic vitality of the region up. So we were very pleased to host that business after hours here. We had a fairly good attendance, and so both Superintendent Swimover and Mr. Peirce spoke, as well as the Executive Director of the Chamber. So it was nice. And I want to thank our DECA students who took those people in attendance on the tour. They did a great job. They were very impressive.
Mr. Schoonover had the opportunity to talk about the future search strategic planning process, and I took the opportunity once again to thank the communities of Somerset and Berkeley for their generous support of education, particularly with respect to the building project. And we talked briefly about the challenges that every community faces in public education these days. A lot of added responsibilities for our administration and faculty in dealing with issues well beyond the classroom in terms of the needs of students these days. And also the need to constantly be moving forward and innovating with our curriculum and trying to prepare our students for a future in the global economy.
I'd like to thank you for organizing the event and just going over for presenting that. Thank you.
And
Baker's Bank sponsored it too, I should
say. Yes.
So thank you.
Generously, once again, a great corporate citizen of the region. And we had an opportunity to meet a lot of people, business people in the area. So it was really very worthwhile. And I'll just, under this item, although it isn't on the agenda, I'll just mention that Mr. Schoonover, myself, and Mr. Ghilarducci, as always, along with his wife, Marge, attended the Day at the Hill on Tuesday. We received some information from members of the legislature about the status of the budget process. It was the budget week in the House, so our representative, Pat Haddad, was extremely busy presiding in the House for part of the day, but she was very gracious, as usual, to meet with us to the extent that time permitted. And we also had a very nice meeting with Senator Rodericks, and we always try to get in a plug for regional transportation aid and getting as close to 100% funding as possible, and he heard that message. So the House has actually added some money to the Chapter 70 fund, I believe, and $52 million over what the governor was proposing in his budget. And usually the way it works is that the House comes in with a lower number, and the Senate comes in with a higher number, and they usually reach consensus somewhere in between. I'm not sure if that's going to happen this year, because the House has raised the governor's proposal from an increase in Chapter 78 from $20 per pupil to $55 per pupil. So they may very well have been kind of stretching the limit of available resources, but we'll see. But that's a positive development, and I believe there was also some additional money added to regional transportation. So we'll see where that all washes out. We probably won't know until close to the end of the fiscal year or into early July. And I also have to add, as I'll let Mr. Ghilarducci add, but we want to thank both Mr. Ghilarducci and his wife Marge, who were instrumental in having our culinary arts students participate in the lunch program that all of the attendees, and there was a very large number of school committee members who were there from all across the state, and our culinary arts students participated. And one of our Chinese student guests was there as well, shadowing one of the culinary arts students, and we had an opportunity to meet him. Told us his name in English is Alan, and Wong in Chinese, I believe. So it was very nice to meet him, and we took time to say hello to all of our students who were there. They did a great job. I don't know if you want to add a little bit.
The other thing that happened is Pat's aide took our students on a tour of the State House. So the State House, and especially that was interesting for the visiting boy from China. He got to see a State House, and he got to get exposed to that. And Mrs. Gloucester did a phenomenal job. She had eight of her students there. And Alan, who is a Chinese young man, was shadowing Sarah. Sarah was his leader, so she was taking him through. So he dined on American Chinese food, which he wasn't that excited about, but he did show everyone how to use chopsticks, because he's a pro, so he was teaching everybody, but it was hard to catch on. He was too good at it, so he did that. And I did have time with our representative, Kiko Orell, who is always very accommodating. She's really great. And I brought her a couple of letters, one from Washington, D.C., and one from the state of New York, blasting Common Core, which I gave to her, and whatever she wants to do with them, I don't know. And the other thing I reviewed with her was a letter that Ed Hoke had written to her, asking for additional help, as he always does. And Dean is nodding his head, because he knows Ed wrote the letter. So she's very charming. She was really hospitable.
She actually joined us, Mr. Schoonover and I, for lunch as well, although she was, again, called away in the middle of lunch to go back into the House chamber for a vote on the budget. So it was, sometimes I wonder why it's scheduled during that week. It was the same situation last
every year.
And as it turned out, I suppose they might schedule it at that time, thinking that we can influence the House's vote on the education budget. But it turned out that the House had dealt with the education portion of the budget the day before, so we were a day late. But I'm not sure we're a dollar short. So. But there, one other thing that did occur to me, some of the school committees bring some students with them.
Yes.
And this year, there was a special program for the students who were in attendance. Some of the school committee members who actually served as student representatives in the past and are now elected school committee members, as well as some aides who work in the State House who had served as student members of the school committee, did a special program for the students as we were off visiting the legislators. So I think that's something we should keep in mind for next year, particularly if we are more in closer touch with the students next year, to think about having a few of them come along with us. We also have a packet of material, and I'm going to ask Robin We tried to get a packet of material for everyone, but unfortunately they ran out. They didn't have enough extras for us to take five home. So we'll ask Robin to copy some of the more important material that's in this packet.
She's smiling away
for everyone next week at our next meeting. Okay. So are there any matters of public input this evening?
I have one, Mr. Chris. I don't know if everyone is aware of it, but May is Older Americans Month, and it's called Blaze a Trail. When Older Americans Month was established in 1963, only 17 million living Americans had reached their 65th birthday. We know today there's a lot more. And so historically, Older Americans Month has been a time to acknowledge the contributions of past and current older persons. This is of our country, but I think we have to think of our towns. And I think of our two shining faces right there all the time. So if you can, pass along good word to one of your grandparents. They should be old enough to be older Americans. And we have to appreciate the fact of what the older Americans have done and continue to do for all of us. So I thank you, gentlemen, for always coming.
Thank you. Mr. Mull.
A brief question. Chapter 20 money, is that fully federally funded or is it partial funds from the federal government and the state?
Chapter 70? Chapter 70 is strictly state funding. It's the Massachusetts statute that provides for funding for public education across the state. Each school district receives an allotment of funding from the state based upon various factors, primarily community wealth and real estate assessment. That's the beginning of the calculation.
We do get quite a bit of money back under chapter 70.
Yes, in excess of $4 million, I believe, this year.
In the event that you come up with a tri-district collaboration, I just thought, is it possible that they might send back package of money and say split it up three ways, in which case we might get less than that. I hope the company you're going to learn is not Fall River, it's Swansea. Is you're going to have a tri-district, is that the idea?
Be the regional school district, the Somerset K-8, and the Berkley K-8. So we're staying within.
Oh, you're not?
Yeah, right. So
well,
when we
I
talk
like
about
the way you're thinking, Mr. Yeah. Mullen. It seems to me like a natural partnership, but I'm not sure we're quite there yet.
Well, I thought we might get less after you merge it. Maybe that's the product of a devious Irish mind, I'm sorry.
No, we wouldn't expect that. Of course, that's one of the things that we'll look at very closely.
Absolutely.
During this study process is whether there would be any impact, but
yeah,
that's
instead of
not likely the case.
Instead of one bank, they said, here, split it up among yourselves, and we get back there. Thank you.
Yes,
it may be preliminary though, but if we regionalize K-8, Somerset, K-8, Berkeley, what about the schools and the land? Would we have to go through the same thing, Julie, that we did here? Sell the land to the regional? Because that we may have a different situation. We don't have Berkeley kids coming to our elementary school. So would you regionalize that and would you wind up incorporating those schools and wind up footing the bill for their maintenances also?
There are different ways that looked at other regional agreements. There are ways that we can do it, but I don't know the answer yet until we all
start. That's a very interesting issue because, quite honestly, Berkeley has two relatively new schools, a relatively new middle school and a relatively new elementary school. And honestly, our elementary and middle school is much older and in need of
much more repair.
Work. So, but these issues are not unique to us. They've been addressed in other regions. I was just looking at a regional agreement from the western part of the state, and in their regional agreement, the individual community, even though they're fully regionalized, the individual communities remain responsible for the maintenance of the buildings that are located in their community.
Okay.
So there are avenues to address those kinds of issues. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Okay.
And one other thing I forgot to ask you. Glad to see that road open over there, Mr. Schmidt.
Yeah.
Me too.
All right, so if there's nothing further, I would entertain a motion pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A2, to enter executive session to conduct contract negotiations with non-union personnel, Director of Special Education, Lisa Martesian. The committee will, because discussion in open session might have a negative impact on the committee's bargaining position, and the committee will not return to open session at the conclusion of the executive session. I have a motion to that effect.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Field and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Is there any discussion? In the absence of discussion, a roll call. Mr. Ghilarducci?
Aye.
Mrs. Field?
Aye.
Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mrs. Gagliardi?
Aye.
Mrs. Terra?
Aye.
Mr. Larabee?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming.